Good morning. This is the fifth Sunday of Lent, and I welcome you to Aberdeen First United Methodist Church worship to praise and worship God. I testify that the Lord expects us to bring souls unto Him by inviting all persons to come, and so by doing, find Him ourselves. We come today to worship and praise God together.
Thank you.
I'm Carolyn Hardy.
And I'm Bill Hardy.
And we are your worship leaders this morning. Please join us as we read responsively our call to worship. When all we have hoped for and trusted in has let us down,
there is Christ who reaches out to us.
When the world seems dark and despair threatens to close in upon us,
there is Christ reaching out for us.
Come and let us worship the Lord, who is always ready to reach out to us.
We humbly come before the Lord in hope and faith. Today's first hymn is Be Thou My Vision.
Let us say the opening prayer together. Let us pray. We come into your presence, O Lord, with so many burdens and concerns on our hearts. Help us to be open to your words of healing and restoration. Bring us closer to you. Enable us to discern your will for us that we may serve you more faithfully by serving others in need. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our children's message today is entitled Our Daily Bread and is based upon the gospel reading of John 12, 1 through 8. The first part of the Lord's Prayer we have been focusing on in our study group with adults, but I am sure that many of you as children have heard the Lord's Prayer. When we focus on God first, we understand more clearly what we need instead of what we want. In this part of the prayer, Jesus says that we can talk to God about us, our family, and all of us together. And the next line says, "Give us this day our daily bread." That means we can ask God for what we need each day. Sometimes we want things that we don't need. But when we ask for daily bread, that means we ask God to give us what we need one day at a time. In this part of the prayer, we are asking God to provide for our immediate needs as we serve God. We are saying that our bread or food, our clothes, all the things we need in life, we turn to God and God will supply. Notice that the prayer says, "our daily bread." That means you should think not just about yourself, but about others as well. I wonder what your and our daily bread means to you. Can you give me some examples of what daily bread that other people need that God can supply? What can you pray for that will affect you, your family, or the world around you that God can provide? Yes, we can pray for food that we need on our table each day. Yes, we can ask for good health for Grandma who has been ill. Yes, we can ask for peace and calm for the Ukrainians and Russians. Those are all good examples. Jesus calls himself the bread of life earlier in the Gospel of John. And Jesus teaches us that he satisfies our spiritual and physical needs. In today's scripture passage, Mary shows how the disciples honor Jesus with everything they have, knowing he will supply their needs. Today and every day, pray to God, our provider. And then pray, "Give us today our daily bread." Let's pray that now. God, who provides and supplies us with everything we need, teach us to turn to you as we ask for our daily bread. Give us our daily bread today, tomorrow, and each and every day. Amen. It comes that time now for us to be able to share our joys and concerns. We are thankful that Christine's second eye surgery has gone well and she is continuing to heal. And we also ask for prayers for Zane, who is going to be going in for surgery for leukemia. And they have a GoFundMe that is almost totally filled up at this point. We also ask prayers for the family of Elaine Schnee. Elaine died last Saturday morning. We continue to ask prayers for Karen and Bill Davison. They are still waiting for the ramp to be put in at their house so that they can move back into their house, and Bill is able to get therapy so that he can learn to walk with his prosthesis. And we know that there are many other prayers as well. And I hope you at home will voice to those around you the prayers that you have as well, and the joys. Let us pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come to you, and you already know what we want to ask, but we still will ask. We ask for healing for those who have had surgery. We ask for you to watch over those performing the surgery on those that still have surgery coming up. And we ask for your love and compassion for the Schnee families as they grieve the loss of their mother, having lost their father only about 7 months ago. Guide and be with Bill and Karen as they find people to install the ramp so that Bill is able to get into their house again. And we ask for peace and calm to come over the people of Ukraine and Russia so that there is an end to the war that they have started. And may we pray for those who also need your healing for physical needs, as well as mental needs, as well as emotional needs. You know the conditions of each person, and may you come to their aid. In your precious name, amen. We are ever thankful for those who have been sending in their tithes and offerings, and also special offerings. Last Sunday was Encore Sunday for the United Methodist Church to cover the administrative costs of Encore, and that is listed on the VanCo online offering as well. If you wish to give to Encore, such as to the Ukraine, that is also on VanCo. It is separate from the Encore administrative cost, because when you donate to Encore for any given designation, it goes 100% to that. But once a year, the United Methodist Church asks for a special offering to cover all administrative costs so that nothing from your donation goes to administration. You can send it to 100 East 2nd Street, Aberdeen, Washington, 98520. Let us pray. Our most Heavenly Father, we are ever thankful for the gifts that have been given and for the donations that have been and offerings that have been brought and sent. Please use them in the best way possible, locally, internationally, and nationally. And may we always be willing to help others in need. In your precious name, amen.
Praise Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. love in our heart. There is joy in our song, for we know that Jesus is ever near. He will give us the faith to be patient and strong, and the courage to face all our fears. Day by day He will help us grow.
Paul's letter to the Philippians. This is chapter 3, verses 4 through 14. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For His sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in Him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of His resurrection and the sharing of His sufferings by becoming like Him in His death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me His own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus.
Holy wisdom, holy word.
Thanks be to God.
Our message today is entitled, Knowing Christ Jesus. One fellow was bragging to another about his grandfather. My grandfather, he said, knew the exact day of the exact year when he was going to die. Not only that, he knew the time he would die that day as well. And his friend said, wow, that's incredible. How did he know all that? And the first fellow said, because a judge told him. Many years back, Carolyn Johnson, a 73-year-old widow, lost her house and all her possessions in a flood. When asked how she was handling the loss, Mrs. Johnson remarked, I've never been in a situation like this. Everything I had in the world is in that house. I don't have anything now, she said, but Jesus. And that's the situation Paul found himself in after his conversion. He lost everything. Like Carolyn Johnson, Paul could say, I don't have anything now but Jesus. Maybe that's not such a bad trade. Maybe it takes losing everything to discover the one thing that is truly important. We first meet Paul in the book of Acts, chapters 7 and 8, and at that time he is a young Pharisee. He is not known as Paul, but Saul. As a native son of Tarsus, Saul is well educated. He is also a zealous member of the Pharisees, a group of Jewish scholars who followed the Mosaic law of purity in their daily life. Even the name Pharisee means separated by special works. And Saul definitely thought that his self-righteousness and zeal for the law set him above other people. Saul sees this new religious group, the Christians, as blasphemers of the Jewish faith. He puts all his energy into persecuting them, even to the point of aiding in the murder of a young Christian evangelist named Stephen. After Stephen's death, Saul heads toward Damascus to arrest more Christians. But as he travels along the road, Saul is blinded by a flash of light, and he is confronted by the voice of Jesus. In that moment, Saul's life is changed. He becomes Paul, a fellow follower of Christ, and the rest of his life is devoted to spreading the good news of Christ. If this were a fairy tale, we could close it right now by saying, and they all lived happily ever after. But that's not the case. Paul lost his position as a Pharisee. We can imagine that his family and friends turned against him, and he became the victim of the same persecution that he used against the Christians. Paul never again had a home of his own. Many times he didn't know where his next meal was coming from. He spent years in prison. He was beaten and abused. Eventually, he was executed by the ruling authorities, all for the sake of Christ. And yet his joy, his faith, his confidence never wavered. He gave up everything for the sake of one thing that truly matters. You are never wrong to trade that which is temporal for that which is eternal. In Paul's situation, we don't have to wonder. The salvation he found in Jesus was worth more than any possession or title ever could be. Paul's situation, we know, at this juncture in his life, had nothing to live with. He had nothing to live with, but he had everything to live for. And here's a question to keep us up at night. What would you and I have to lose in order to find Jesus? In other words, what is standing in the way, keeping us from saying yes with our whole heart, like Paul did, when we sense that Jesus is calling us? And we can fill in the blanks. My social status, my material possessions, my desire for approval, my spiritual apathy, my need for control, my self-centeredness, my fear, my guilt, and shame? What is it that is standing between you and a wholehearted commitment to following Jesus? For Paul, there were many obstacles to overcome: the law of Moses, his family lineage, his own self-righteousness, his social standing. But something gave Paul the ability to turn his back on all he once considered important in order that he might embrace the one thing that couldn't be taken away from him. An allegory tells about a man who died and went to heaven. And just outside of heaven was a huge arena called the Court of Status Symbols. Before this man could get into heaven, he had to go through this arena, past the keeper of the door of the court. And inside this Court of Status Symbols, he saw sleek automobiles, membership cards to exclusive clubs, silver-tipped canes, etc. As he went farther back into the room, he saw the crowns of kings and beautiful jewelry from princesses. And then the guide said, "Yes, these were all things that the world uses to impress people, symbols of significance, but they don't impress God. So we have everybody drop them right here before they come to stand before the Almighty. What are those things that you will need to leave behind in the Court of Status Symbols in order to stand before God?" Billionaire H.L. Hunt was once asked for his philosophy of success. And he said, if you want to be a success, you need to do two things. One, make a decision about what you want in life. And two, make a decision about what you're willing to give up to get it. That's called setting priorities. And sometimes it takes a blinding, life-changing moment like Paul's Damascus Road experience to help us get our priorities in order. In 1963, Texas Governor John Conley was injured in the assassination attack on President John F. Kennedy. Conley says that the experience profoundly changed his life. In a newspaper interview, Conley explained, "As far as Nellie, his wife, and I are concerned, I think the more lasting impression it made on us was that it inevitably brought into sharper focus what's really important in life. And we have since that time tried to act and conduct ourselves in a way that we don't engage in such trivia, and we try not to participate in things that are shallow or in the long run meaningless. Sometimes it takes a dramatic experience to bring things that are really important into focus." When we have a strong sense of what is important, though, it can free us in ways we can't even imagine. Pastor John Ton decided to return to his native Romania after spending many years in England. The other seminary students urged Ton to stay in England. If he returned to Romania, his life would be in danger. But Joseph Ton knew that God was leading him back to his home country. His friends were right, though. After his return to Romania, he was persecuted and harassed by the police. One day, a particular police officer threatened to kill him, and Joseph Ton responded by saying, "Sir, your supreme weapon is killing. My supreme weapon is dying. Sir, you know my sermons are all over the country on tapes now. If you kill me, I will be sprinkling them with my blood. Whoever listens to them after that will say, 'I'd better listen. This man sealed it with his blood.' My sermons will speak 10 times louder than before. So go on and kill me. I win the supreme victory then." After that day, Joseph Ton never again doubted God's call on his life. He preached without fear, and he said, "For years I was a Christian, who was cautious because I wanted to survive. I had accepted all the restrictions the authorities put on me because I wanted to live. Now I wanted to die, and they wouldn't oblige. Now I could do whatever I wanted in Romania. And for years, I wanted to save my life, and I was losing it. Now that I wanted to lose it, I was winning it. How have your priorities changed since you gave your life to Christ? William Manson spoke a challenging word concerning the nature of the Christian life. He said, "The life the Christian is called to live with Christ is not simply an improved version or expansion of the life of the past, but a contradiction of that former life. Are you the same person you were before you met Christ? Do you value the same things? Are your energies and attentions fragmented among a million different concerns? Or do you, like Paul, have only one priority? To press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." There is a story about a lecture an esteemed theologian once gave at the University of Chicago Divinity School. In this lecture, the theologian sought to prove that the resurrection of Jesus was a myth. He quoted scholar after scholar and book after book. He concluded that since there was no such thing as the historical resurrection, the religious tradition of the church was groundless, because it was based on a relationship with a risen Jesus, who in fact never rose from the dead in any literal sense. He then asked if there were any questions. After about 30 seconds, an old preacher stood up in the back of the auditorium. "Doctor, I got one question," he said, as all eyes turned toward him. The old preacher reached into his sack lunch, pulled out an apple, and began eating it. "Doctor," crunch, munch, crunch, munch, "my question is a simple question," crunch, munch, crunch, munch. "Now, I ain't never read them books you read," crunch, munch, crunch, munch, "and I can't recite the scriptures in the original Greek," crunch, munch, crunch, munch. He finished the apple. "All I want to know is, this apple I just ate, was it bitter or sweet?" And the theologian paused for a moment and answered in exemplary scholarly fashion, "I cannot answer that question, for I haven't tasted your apple." And the white-haired preacher dropped the core of his apple into his crumpled paper bag, looked up at the theologian and said calmly, "Neither have you tasted my Jesus." The auditorium erupted with applause and cheers. The esteemed theologian thanked his audience and promptly left the platform. Once Paul had tasted the glory of the risen Christ, he knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that absolutely nothing could compare to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus. And with that knowledge came unquenchable joy, peace, courage, and confidence. One of the most haunting questions of the church is, what if Paul had said no? What if he had refused to give his life to Jesus? The whole course of human history would have been affected. But here's the question I want you to think about. What if you and I said yes? What if you and I said yes wholeheartedly to following Jesus no matter what the cost? Who knows what could happen? Praise be to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Okay, it is time now for communion, and we have the elements of bread and juice, and hopefully you have a piece of bread or cracker and a liquid of some form of juice or water. Put this by you, those that need it too. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is a right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You brought all things into being and called them good. From the dust to the earth of the earth, you formed us into your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. And when rain fell upon the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, you bore up the ark on the waters, saved Noah and his family, and made covenant with every living creature on earth. When you led your people to Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, you gave us your commandments and made us your covenant people. And when your people forsook your covenant, your prophet Elijah fasted for 40 days and 40 nights. And on your holy mountain, he heard your still small voice. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When you gave him to save us from our sin, your Spirit led him into the wilderness, where he fasted 40 days and 40 nights to prepare for his ministry. And when he suffered and died on the cross for our sin, you raised to life him to life, presented him alive to the apostles during 40 days, and exalted him at your right hand. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. Now, when your people prepare for the yearly feast of Easter, you lead us to repentance for sin and the cleansing of our hearts, that during these 40 days of Lent, we may be gifted and graced to reaffirm the covenant you made with us through Christ. On the night in which he gave himself up, he took bread, and he gave thanks to you. And he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup. And he gave thanks to you. And then he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on those of us gathered here and those of you gathered wherever you're viewing from, and on these elements today. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. And by your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. and as children of God, let us say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And as we have one loaf, we break this one loaf to show that even though we are one in Christ, it is to be shared with all. And likewise, we have one cup of salvation. This one cup is poured out for everyone. The body of Christ. And blood of his salvation poured out. And for those of you at home, let us take our bread or cracker, the body of Christ, and the blood of his salvation poured out for you. Amen. Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this feast that we are able to have, knowing that we come closer to you, especially during this Lenten season, as we feast at your table. In your precious name, amen. And as we come to the end of the service, let us know the blessing. Go in peace. And may God's peace go with you. Bring hope and healing to all whom you meet. Amen. And remember who you are, and remember to whom you belong. Amen.